Mars Hill. Wonderful seeing each and every one here today. Just a few announcements, things that are happening, will be happening in the next couple of weeks. I'll encourage everybody to please look through their bulletins as there's a lot of things going on. Also, I want to make sure I don't forget this. We do have one of our Sunday school classes that had perfect attendance today. That is the friendship class, so let's give them a big round of applause this morning. And as always, if you aren't connected with a Sunday school class, we'd love to connect you up there with one, and that you might study the Word of God together and have fellowship with one another. As always, we are so thankful for our hardworking Sunday school teachers. They do a great job always. Please look for your bulletins. We have a lot of things that are occurring over the next couple of weeks. Vacation Bible School is one of the big ones. A lot of information there in the bulletin about that. And I encourage everybody to be inviting others to come and be a part of this. Really quick, I want to make sure, because we do have a business meeting today, but right after the service today, deacons, if you will, please meet to my left, your right, right over by the organ here. Just real quick, going to talk about some things, so if you will do that. And also, this is something we found out this week, and I want to make sure I get word out, and I also I will do what I can to spread the word. This Wednesday, I know this Wednesday we were going to be having the choir practice at 6 o'clock, but we have something so much more fun occurring this Wednesday. This Wednesday, for all of our seniors, there is going to be a meal provided for you from 6 o'clock to 8 o'clock. Just a great time of fellowship, so please go ahead and come out 6 o'clock to 8 o'clock this Wednesday night. We'll be meeting in the fellowship hall for a time of fellowship and food. So please keep that in mind. Write that down. We're not going to be having our Wednesday night Bible study or anything. We're just going to be enjoying this night of fellowship together. And that will be this Wednesday. So please keep that in mind as well. I see you. Yes, I see you. Okay.
High school seniors.
Huh?
Youth group for high school seniors.
I am sorry. I didn't. See now, okay.
Youth group, high school
singing. I'm sorry. So, all right, here we go. Here we go. Now I'm gonna pull. It's a big difference. That's true. I apologize for that. So, also Wednesday, June 28th from 6 to 8, we're having a cookout for our seniors at church.
That's one of the youth group leaders.
That is true. That is my fault. So I apologize. Forget that. Forget everything I said. Rewind. I apologize. What we are going to be doing is choir. Y'all going to be meeting here at 6 o'clock. Yep. You just canceled. I can bring it back.
Okay. How about the seniors are welcome to come to the cookout?
No, that's not it. That's not it. This is my fault. What we're going to do, is it okay if we have choir practice?
Yes.
Okay.
Is it okay if we have the choir practice?
Okay. Yeah. Choir practice here in the sanctuary at 6 o'clock on Wednesday. 7 o'clock, we're going to be doing our Bible study in Job. So, I apologize. For our high school seniors, for the youth that are high school seniors, that's where y'all are going to be having a nice meal. From 6 o'clock to 8 o'clock. Sorry. We need to laugh in church. Amen?
Amen.
It's better to laugh at me than other things. So, all good there. I do apologize for that. Oh, goodness. Now I'm off track. That's okay. We've got to get back on track now. Please look through your bulletins, other things in there. Anything else that I've forgotten? Anything else coming up?
Daniel,
yes.
I want to say, Brenda Ray has been moved to Grosdale.
Yes.
But her birthday is Wednesday. So anybody who would like to send her a birthday card, encouragement, whatever, just send it to her house, because the girls are going by there every day and said they would pick up the cards and take them to her so that she could get them on her birthday. But she is allowed visitors if you'd like to go too, but we just thought it would be nice to celebrate her birthday with
her. And yes, and I have addresses for Brenda Ray as well. Yeah, I went ahead and called this week, and so yes, if you want to know where Brenda Ray's at, and if you want to mail something directly to her, I do have that address. I'll be happy to give you right after the service. But yes, she did. Brenda Ray got out of the hospital and is at Crowsdale Village, and she's going through rehab, and Lord willing, she will be able to get home soon. Any other requests? Arms up, shoot a flare. All right. Well, this morning, let's go ahead and begin our service. Diane, I'll ask you to come to deliver our invocation this morning as we begin our worship service together.
Let us pray. Dear Lord, what a beautiful day, what a beautiful sunshine we see coming into the building. We just thank you so much for that. Thank you also for the rain that we've had this week, a time of replenishing to the earth. We just thank you so much for all that you provide to us each and every day. We just thank you for the big things, the miracles that you provide to us, or that we get to see in your world each and every day. But most of all, we just thank you so much for the little things, the things that we see you doing for us each and every day. We just see your hand, and we just feel your love, and we just feel you working in our lives, and we just thank you so much for that. I cannot even imagine living a life without you, without no hope, and in this world that we're living in, and having to face the tough times without you. But there's so many people in this world that do that, that have tough times, that see everything that's going on, and they have no faith and no hope. And they won't have that unless we provide that to them, unless we show the light to them. Dear Lord, help us to be the light that provides what they need in this world. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Well, today, let's go ahead and look at your bulletins or give attention to the screen as we have our responsive reading. It's from Psalm 24, verses 1 through 5. Let's stand to our feet as we recite the Word of God together. The Bible says this: "The earth is the Lord's and all its fullness, the world and those who dwell therein. For he has founded it upon the seas and established it upon the waters. Who may ascend into the hill of the Lord? Or who may stand in his holy place? He who has clean hands and a pure heart, who has not lifted up his soul to an idol, nor sworn deceitfully. He shall receive blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation." Sing with me as we go in our hymnals, hymn number 143, "This is my Father's world." Let's sing all three verses unto the Lord today.
Oh, nature's sea.
lift up and not only to pray for, but also to praise the Lord for. Many have asked me already about David Carter's surgery, and I am very, very pleased and thankful to announce from getting a text directly from Megan, also seeing him in the hospital. As the surgery began, as the doctors worked, everything was going according to plan. And then afterwards, she had mentioned that the doctor was confident that he was able to remove all of the cancer, and which is a huge praise. The prayer request now is that that we would pray that David would make a speedy recovery. He has gone through a lot with this surgery, he's got a long road of recovery. But the prayer is that that would occur, that he would gain health, and that he would be able to get up on his feet and be able to do regular things once again. But we are very, very grateful for that. Also, if you will, in your prayers, please add, excuse me, Janet Lovett. This is Bertha Carter's sister. Unfortunately, this week she fell and broke her leg. Is at UNC Hospital. She had to have surgery. The surgery went well. She's just going through rehab now, trying to get her strength back and being able to be mobile again. So please remember Janet as well in your prayers. As I mentioned before, please remember Brenda Ray as she has moved from the hospital to Crowsdale. I'm very grateful for that. And, please pray the Lord would continue to give her strength and be able to recover completely. excuse me, I lost my train of thought there, I apologize. Continue also to remember Rocky Wilkerson, still at home. Please pray that the Lord would give strength. I know he is eating and trying to gain some weight. But please pray that he's receiving infusions, some and all that these things would do what they're supposed to do, and that he would continue to be able to gain strength there. Also, if you will, please remember Raymond Pennell. Raymond is Philip Pennell's brother. He goes in tomorrow for bypass surgery. So please pray that the Lord would let this surgery be successful. He's going through a couple of bypasses, that everything would go well there, to be able to, this would go off without a hitch, and everything would go well there as well. I would also ask that we remember all of the many that I know are traveling this week, that are on vacations and going to various places. Pray for safety. In their journeys, that everybody be able to get back home well and safe. Continue also, if you will, remember Vacation Bible School in your prayers as we come, and it's quickly coming upon us. We'll be decorating soon. We'll be getting everything ready. Pray the Lord would just bless during that time as well. This morning, who else can we remember today in our prayers? Let's go before the Lord. I'm going to ask Randy to come, as we have also a special time just to pray for Vacation Bible School for its success. So Randy, would you come and pray for us? Pray specifically also for Vacation Bible School, that all would be well there.
Let's pray. Father, we just thank you so much that we can come to you this morning. Father, so many needs in the church, and Father, we do pray that you'd be a comfort and continue just to heal up people quickly. Father, we thank you for the good news that you give to us, that Jesus has come and died for us and is now alive, sitting at the right hand of the Father. Just thank you, Father, that for Mars Hill, that we're a light to this area, that we can share the good news with those around us. I just thank you so much for this church. Father, thank you for our children and for the youth. Father, we just pray for them into the future. I just pray that each one of them would grow to be men and women of you, Lord, that would love you and would depend on you. And we just pray that for each one of them. Pray that you would touch their hearts. We just especially think about the Vacation Bible School coming up, and for all the teachers and volunteers, preparation now and process. Just really pray for wisdom for the teachers and the volunteers, just getting things in order. Thank you that just even the details, you'll be in that. And we just thank you so much for your help with that. Father, we just pray, even as we hand out invitations, that you would touch hearts there, that as we go around, just being able to pray for people and invite them. Just pray for a good crowd this year, a good group of children and young people and adults to come out. Father, you can bring people in. We ask that you would do that, Father. And especially even for follow-up, I just pray, even as we follow up Vacation Bible School, the young families, we could bring young families into the church. We pray that, Father. Not to us be the glory, but to you be the glory, Father, for your love and faithfulness. In Jesus' name we pray.
This time, let me call the children forth for our children's sermon. Got a simple little lesson today. Nothing too complex, but I wanted to make sure we kind of covered a little bit here. See, last week, what was last week? You remember what last week was? No. Last week was Sunday, right? Okay, one back 1 week. Do you remember what last week was? Like, it was a holiday last week. Do you remember what it was? I know we had the youth here and all that. It's okay. You phone a friend if you want to. What's it? Church, what was last week? 1, 2, 3, go.
Father's Day.
So last week was Father's Day. And with it being Father's Day, with the youth being here, we really weren't kind of like able to really, really celebrate that. So I kind of really wanted to do that today and talk a little bit more about dads and who they are. And
There we go.
Okay, that's better. Talk about who they are and all. And so there's three kind of pictures up there. There's bread. There's different like sports things, like balls and baseball, football, basketball, right? And there's also a Bible. And this is what I'm gonna tell y'all, but I'm aiming for y'all, but I'm really aiming back behind you too, because being a good dad has to do with bread and a ball and a Bible. The idea of bread is twofold. Good dads provide. They provide good homes, and they provide finances. They provide safety, and they provide a good relationship. And they provide a place that is loving. Luke 11, verses 11 through 13, Jesus says, "What father among you, if his son asks for a fish, will instead of a fish give him a serpent? Or if he asks an egg, will he give a scorpion? If you then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him?" And the idea is, you know, what good dad, if you ask your dad for a piece of bread and gives you a rock, is that being really nice? No, not unless he like gives you a diamond or something. That's a different type of rock. But in Jesus' time, the loaves of bread that they would bake, those round loaves of bread, they looked a lot like the rocks that were around Jerusalem that they would use to build, that they would use just regular rocks that they had. So you can see why Jesus would say that. You know, oh, here, sink your teeth into this. It looks like bread, but it's not. Dads can think about that bread. They provide loving and good things into our lives. And you know what? That's one of the reasons why we ought to thank our dads and say, "I love you, Dad, and thank you so much for providing such good things." But the second one is the idea of the ball. And I think about it. Has your dad ever thrown a baseball, football, basketball with you? Done anything? Frisbee? Okay. So you don't back and forth. I did basketball at one of my grandparents' house, in my house. Threw football. The idea is good dads are also good teachers. Good dads have the idea of spending time with our kids. And you know, that's one of the things that God ordained, that our dads are ones that teach kids. So my encouragement is that you would also say thank you to your dads for the lessons that they teach you. And of course, the last one is the Bible. And you know, all dads are called to be men of God, to know the things of the Bible, to know about Jesus dying on the cross, that they might teach it to you, but also might live it out. So there's another reason why you can thank your dad. So I kind of give that out. I give that to y'all to kind of give you a reason to thank everybody. But you know, I also give that out to all the guys that are out here today, because that's what we're all called to be. We're called to be ones that provide and bless. We're called to be ones that teach, and we're called to be ones that know the Bible well. And it's through all of those things that good and wonderful blessings can come. So my encouragement is, acknowledge your dad. I know you probably did that last week, but you can always acknowledge him again and say thank you, Dad. But also to all the other dads, grandfathers, to thank them, to appreciate them as well today. You know, I was starting to think, I had no idea. I'm not one for giving out basketballs or anything, so I'm not gonna do that. But I am gonna give you something good. I give you that. Give them a big round of applause. Now, at this time, I'd also, as they go back to their seats, I'll call the ushers forth that we might prepare our hearts for the tithes and offerings. Our offertory scripture today comes from 1 Chronicles 16, verses 29. And verse 29, ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come before him. Worship the Lord in the splendor of holiness. Roger, would you ask a blessing on this offering we're about to receive?
Thank you, Lord, for this beautiful day. I would ask that you bless all the money that is put into these plates today. Use it for the enhancement of your kingdom. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Bibles, please be turning, if you will, to Deuteronomy 5 and Deuteronomy 6, chapter 5 and chapter 6 of Deuteronomy. Find it all the way at the very front of the Bible. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers. Deuteronomy 5, verses 27 through chapter 6 and verse 18. Word of God says this, "Go near and hear all that the Lord our God will say. Speak to us all that the Lord our God will speak to you, and we will hear and do it. The Lord heard your words when he spoke to me, and the Lord said to me, I have heard the words of this people which they have spoken to you. They are right in all they have spoken. Oh, that they had such a heart as this always, to fear me and to keep all my commandments, that it might go well with them and their descendants forever. Go and say to them, return to your tents, but you stand here by me, and I will let you and I will tell you the whole commandments and the statutes and the rules that you shall teach them, then that they may do them in the land that I am giving them to possess. You shall be careful, therefore, to do as the Lord your God has commanded you. You shall not turn aside to the right or to the left. You shall walk in all the way that the Lord your God has commanded you, that you may live and that it may go well with you, that you may live long in the land and that you shall possess. Now, this is the command, the statutes and the rules that the Lord your God commanded me to teach you, that you may do them in the land to which you are going over to possess it, that you may fear the Lord your God, you and your son's son, by keeping all his statutes and his commandments, which I commanded you all the days of your life, and that your days may be long. Hear therefore, O Israel, and be careful to do them, that it may go well with you, and that you may multiply greatly as the Lord, the God of your fathers, has promised you, in a land flowing with milk and honey. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might. And these words that I command you today shall be in your hearts. You shall teach them diligently to your children and shall talk of them when you sit in your house and when you walk by the way and when you lie down and when you rise. You shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be as frontlets between your eyes. You shall write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates. And when the Lord your God brings you into the land that he swore to your fathers, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob, to give you with great and good cities that you did not build, and houses full of all good things that you did not fill, and cisterns that you did not dig, and vineyards and olive trees that you did not plant. And when you eat and are full, then you will take care lest you forget the Lord who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. It is the Lord your God you shall fear. Him you shall serve, and by his name you shall swear. You shall not go after other gods, the gods of the people who are around you. For the Lord your God is in the midst, is a jealous God, lest the anger of the Lord your God be kindled against you, and he destroy you from off the face of the earth. You shall not put the Lord your God to the test, as you tested him at Manasseh. You shall diligently keep the commands of the Lord your God, and his testimonies and his statutes which he has commanded you. And you shall do what is right and good in the sight of the Lord, that it may go well with you, and that you may go in and take possession of the good land that the Lord swore to give to your fathers." May God bless the reading of his word. Why go ahead and preach a Father's Day message when it's not Father's Day? Very simply, because it's important. Because fathers and men are vital. And we live in a society that fathers, dare I say, just men in general, are not looked upon very favorably. Let me give two very simple facts in a beginning. Number one is men are devalued today. Think about it on the television shows that are out. The character of a father, are they strong? Are they wise? Are they leaders? Do they know what's going on? More often than not, they are dumb, they are the butt of jokes, they are foolish, and they need to be bailed out by others. You didn't think about it in the last couple of years. This is very disturbing, but it's been over the news, and it's been basically everywhere on magazines that some of the most talked about men in America are those men that decided they were going to be women. We live in a society with a mentality that a man, that masculinity, that fatherhood is not very necessary. And that is a very, very sad thing. Here's another simple fact. Men are of tremendous value. Men are of tremendous values. Ladies, let me say this from the start. I'm not going to do anything in this message, but you bang on. Women are vitally important in our world. My goal is not to diminish you in any way. I have a goal with this. I want to encourage our men. I want to call our fathers, our men, to be the men God has called them to be. I want to call our young men, our future fathers, into the roles that God has called them into, because men are important. They find that the best chance at the next generation in our families is if a mother and a father are both attending church at the same time. Men, your presence here today is amazing. It is the greatest chance, more so than just a mom, more so than just a dad. It is a mom and a dad both being in church at the same time is the greatest chance for that next generation to become worshipers. We look at it in schools. It's when moms and dads are both active and in the same home, in a good, loving relationship, in a marriage, that students have the best chance at making good grades, of not falling ill to mental health problems. It is the best chance. Dads, listen. Men, listen. You have tremendous, tremendous value. Do not let this world ever devalue in that. Know your worth, not from this world, but rather from God. So today, as we look at Deuteronomy, I want to look at three things that God cares about. Let me give you a kind of a background about what all is going on here in Deuteronomy. Moses is at the very, 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 very end of his life. God has already said, you know what, Moses, because of your error at Kadesh, all the way back in Numbers 20, you aren't going to be entering into the promised land. So Deuteronomy is basically Moses' last sermon. It is a long sermon. It would take a few hours, take about 4 or 5 hours. If I were to read Deuteronomy, aren't you glad my sermons are not that long? All God's people said.
Amen.
But it's Moses passing the torch on to Joshua, but he's also telling the people, hey, look, I know that you are going to go out into this promised land. You're going to possess it, but I want to give you some ground rules on what you need to do to be successful. To show you what God cares about that will propel you into great success. And he focuses in on one generation going into the next generation. He's not just talking about next week, next month, next year. He's talking about generations beyond. And it speaks so much to men as well as women. Let me go first with the first thing that God cares about. First, God cares about your legacy. God cares about your legacy. A lot of times when we think about legacy, we think about businesses. We think about something like Coca-Cola. Coca-Cola's been around a long time. They've got a legacy. You can go down to Georgia. You can go to the Coca-Cola bottling plant. You can go to their headquarters. And they've got a lot of things about their history. about all the things they did, all the advertisements, all the endorsements, and how they have gone to a local little company to something that is worldwide. John Deere, a legacy of making tractors and farm equipment. Ford, American company, pioneered the idea of an assembly line. It has a legacy of automobiles. But you know, you and I, we all have a legacy. We all have a legacy that we came from and that we are leaving behind. And you know, God, in this, the midst of this passage, talks about that legacy. He talks about not just these people, but the generations that were to come. And friends, let me say this. We ought to be concerned about our legacy. We're concerned about so many other things. God, I want to honor you with my money. I want to honor you with my body. I want to honor you with my speech. I want to honor you with my witness, with my service. I want to honor you with all of those things. We ought to also say, Lord, I want to honor you with my legacy. Let me tie this back into the scripture. Deuteronomy 5, if you go back just a little bit, you go to 5 and verse 22, we find that God spoke to all the people. You think about that. It was probably a couple of million, 2 million or so Jews at the time. God spoke to them. What an amazing thing to hear the voice of God. It was kind of funny what happened after that. And basically, the people came up to Moses and said, listen, we heard God. We don't want to go through that again. That was scary. God talks to you, you talk to us, Moses, and we'll do whatever it is that you say. And look what God says in verse 29. Oh, that they had such a heart as this always, to fear me and to keep all my commandments, that it might go well with them and with their descendants forever. God cared about their legacy. That means the things that we do here and now, it matters going on in the days and the weeks and the months and the years and the decades ahead. Mom and Dad, the way you live will rub off on your kids. The way you live will rub off onto this next generation. The things you celebrate will be what they celebrate. The things they love, you love, will be the things they love. The things you do will rub off and will be the things they do. If we're not careful, though, we can derail. God said, listen, the heart that you have right now is going to be important. And he cares about that idea of a legacy. Chapter 6 and verse 2, then you may fear the Lord your God, and you and your sons and your sons' sons, by keeping all his statutes and his commandments, which I commanded you all the days of your life, that your days may be long. Two quick things. How you live has a generational effect. How you live has a generational effect. I was blessed in growing up. We had a great youth minister growing up. His name was Doug Roberts. And I cherished him. What a great, great man of God it was when I was growing up and in youth group. And you know, one of the things that Doug promoted and the church promoted was scripture memory. I still have a Bible where I memorized the most scripture of my Sunday school class for Bible verses. I love that. That was great. But you know, one of the things that had the most impact on me in that? And the idea of saying, hey, you know what, the Bible is really, really important. It was my grandfather quoting Psalm 1-2. Grandfather's a great man of God. He was a deacon at his church, and the pastor there had encouraged the deacons, I want you to memorize Psalm 1. And he committed that thing to memory. He just, boom, he had it. And I remember coming back home from college. This is after I had surrendered to the call of ministry. He actually sat me down and he said, look what I'm doing. And he was memorizing and he gave it to me. And you know what? That had an impact in my life far more than everything at church. Everything at church had a great impact, but it was something about that. Men, let me encourage you. What you do now, what you do now with your life has a generational effect. It goes to your children and to your grandchildren. It says this, what you do matters. But notice also this, how you live also has a present effect. How you live has a present effect. The very last part of verse 2, that your days may be long. You can look throughout the book of Proverbs and it talks about the way we live affects the way we live. Now, if we make good and godly choices, it blesses our life and it helps us. So, dads, let me encourage you, and ladies too. The life that you're leading right now with God saying, you know what? You're setting yourself up for a great legacy. Yeah, I can look at your life right now and I can see that legacy that's going and I can see 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 years down the line, and right now you're putting a good road down. God cares first about your legacy. But notice also this, God cares about your love. God cares about your love. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Verse 4, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. And these words that I command to you today shall be on your hearts. It's interesting. You can't hide what you love. You love something, you can try to hide it. You know, you can go, well, you know, I don't want everybody to know I love Rocky Road ice cream or something. But you know, inevitably, somebody's going to find you with a big old stash of it in your house. Or you're going to find you at a Baskin Robbins just chowing down in a big old tub. You can't hide what you love. And the things that you love are passed down. And I've seen this in the good, and I've seen this in the bad. I've seen this in the good with the integrity that a father will hand down to his son. Saying, you know what, I want to be truthful, I want to be hardworking, I want to be all these things. I've also seen it in the negative aspect, when a father absolutely loves alcohol, and that is passed down to his sons, and it ruins their lives too. What we love is visible. It's passed down, so we have to figure out, okay, what do we love? And it's amazing what God does here. God says, listen, I'm going to show you what you need to do to love. You need to love me with everything that you've got, your heart, your mind, and all of your might. And basically, in the Hebrew way of doing that, it was your body, it was your soul, and anything else that was left. Every bit of it. And guys and ladies, let me encourage you in this respect. Let me give you the first little sub-point here. This is probably the most important little sub-point we've got. It's not about being perfect. It's about being sincere. It's not about being perfect. It's about being sincere. Because listen, parents, I'm going to encourage you this way. Parents, your kids know you're not perfect. I hope that's not a revelation to anybody. Your kids know you're not perfect. It didn't come as a big surprise or anything like that. But you know what your kids need? Sincerity. That when you get in a fight or you mess up or you do something like that, you honestly and resolutely and truthfully apologize. That they see that you have a genuine love of Christ. That they know that you're not a phony, but rather you are true. It's not about being perfect, it's about being sincere. But notice also this, you cannot pass on to others what you do not possess. Dads, moms, kids, if you want a close relationship with God, you want to pass it along to the next generation, let me say this, you first have to have it. A lot of times, Allison, Grace, and I, we're all out at the store, we'll go to Walmart, we'll do our shopping there. And inevitably, my wife and daughter will mosey over to the part of Walmart that I know nothing about, the makeup section. I am worthless when it comes to that. You can tell me a product, you can tell me what it is, and I can go, that doesn't sound like a product. I don't know what that sounds like. All I know about the makeup section is I can get lost in it. I don't know what anything is, but everything's expensive. That's what I know. But you know what? If you go 10 or 15 years from now and you see Grace and you see her and you go, oh, Grace, you look very nice today. Your makeup is done really well. I just want to let you know right here now, I had nothing to do with that. Nothing. But you know, if you go 10, 15 years from now, and Grace wants to talk about her faith, my hope is my name is used in the story. Because there's something I've got that I want her to have. And moms and dads, my hope is in your heart, you want to pour that also out onto the lives of your children. You don't want to go in and say, yeah, I've had nothing to do with that. Friends, listen, salvation is available in Christ. We are able to have our faith there. We are able to grow in that. And He is able to blossom within us a wonderful life in Him that we are able to pass down. Friends, we ought not to miss that opportunity. God cares about what you love. The question is, what do you love today? Finally, this, real quick. God cares about your convictions. God cares about your convictions. Verse number 6. And these words that I command you today shall be on your hearts. You shall teach them diligently to your children and ask of them when you sit in your house and when you walk by the way and when you lie down and when you rise up. My grandfather, his house was where we did all the repairs on our cars. He kind of had it set up, and he had all the tools. So inevitably, I learned how to change oil from my dad and from my grandfather. And being over at my grandfather's house, there was one thing he was very, very convicted about. But when you got that oil filter off of the underside of the car, all the oil drained out, and you were going to put the new filter on, he always got out a new thing of oil, and he would make me dip my finger in it, and I had to go around that seal on that oil filter because he didn't want it binding. He wanted it kind of slide in when you screwed it back in. Every single time, always do it. First time I was doing it, I was like, okay, he was explaining the whole thing to me. Second time, third time, umpteen different times. It didn't matter, I don't know how many times we changed oil in various vehicles. Every single time he was convicted. Why? Because he wanted that passed on to me. He impressed it onto me. I can still remember finger in there doing the whole nine yards. I would even go so far as to do it and get everything ready and do it. And then he would say, now wait a minute here, we got to do this. I'm like, I already did it. He was convicted about that. He was passionate about that. Parents, dads, men, when you're living for God and you have a passion for God, you're going to want to impress some of that onto the next generation. Your passion for prayer. Your passion for telling others about Christ. Your passion for serving. Your passion for giving. You're going to impress that upon the next generation. I've gotten stories from many of you, your parents, reading the Bible to you as a child when you're about ready to go to bed. It impressed those things on you. That conviction then was lived out. Two quick things and we'll be done. Don't forget this first. We live out what is important to us. We live out what is important to us. I had a great uncle. It's my grandfather's brother. Had a lot of difficulties in life, a lot of various physical disabilities. But he loved two things. He loved the Washington Redskins, and he loved the New York Yankees. And it didn't matter what time of the day he went over to his house. It didn't matter what was going on. He had a baseball game going on. He loved it. He greatly enjoyed his baseball. He loved his football. But that was one of the things he just, you saw it all in his life. Now, he was one of the church. He had perfect attendance awards at Sunday school class. I'm not trying to paint him out to be somebody that just loved football and baseball. But I remember him just loving baseball so, so much. You just saw it throughout his life. Friends, if somebody saw you today, what would they say is important to you? And is Jesus one of the things they would say? Finally, it is. If it's not in your heart, you will have very little impact on others' hearts. The simple truth is, you can't give what you don't have. God is telling his people, men in particular right here, love me, but don't just do it superficially. Love me with all of your heart. In fact, put my commands in your heart. Love me with all your heart, and all your soul, and all your might. Get it in there and make it genuine, because then all of my work is really basically done, because it's just going to come out of you. And it's going to be poured out onto the next generation and bless them. And friends, you know what? That's what I want our men to be. That's what I would like everybody here today. Ones that just so love Jesus that it can't help but go to that next generation. It can't help but be seen in the next generation. It can't help but be felt by the next generation, saying, you know what, I know many things about my mom, I know many things about my dad, but one thing I know beyond any shadow of doubt, they love Jesus. Let us be that type of church that loves Jesus and creates that legacy. Let's stand with our heads bowed. It could be today, in talking about these things, the Holy Spirit's laid something on your heart. I don't know. You know, it could be that the Lord's just been pressed upon you that you've never even really thought about a legacy of what you're leaving behind. But maybe today is that day you're saying, Lord, you know what? I really want to leave a good legacy, and I need you to help me to be able to leave that to my kids and my grandkids. Maybe God's just looking at your life and saying, hey, you know what? The legacy that you're leaving isn't really the best of ones. Maybe you need to get the life back on track. Maybe you need to come back to me. Or it could be today you're saying, you know what? I just don't know Jesus as my Lord and Savior, but you know what? Today I want to. I want today to be the start of the legacy. I want today to be the start of godliness. I'd love to show you through the Word of God how you might know Christ as your Lord and Savior, of how you might know Him in a real and meaningful way, that you might walk with Him throughout all of your days. Whatever the needs, the time that as a church we're able to do business together, we're able to come and pray for one another. It could be in your seat. It could be here at the altar. Regardless of that, this is that time for us. Father, work on the hearts of those that are here, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. This morning, hymn number 305, Jesus Paid It All. We're going to sing the first, the second, and the fourth verse. Would you come as we sing?
Oh.
forget, deacons, immediately following, please come to the front. And also, don't forget, we do have a business meeting immediately following the service today. Ephesians 6 and verse 24, grace be with all who love our Lord Jesus Christ with love incorruptible. And all God's people said,
amen.
Thank you. You are dismissed.